Let's pray. Father, we invite you into this time with us by the power
of your Spirit. We pray that your word would penetrate our hearts. That, Lord, you would open us up to all that you have for us in Christ. And I pray, Lord, you would enable me to get out of the way, that you might speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I've often assumed that the English language was probably the most difficult of all the languages to learn, or one of the most difficult. We have so many words that have so many different meanings, but even more confusing are the colloquialisms and the idioms that we have. Phrases like raining cats and dogs, or he bought the farm, which means nothing about real estate, and somebody died. Or how about this? Something's very expensive and it cost an arm and a leg. Can you imagine for a foreigner who's making a business transaction the horror of being told that? The thing is we also have regional sayings and idioms that even though we live in the same country and we speak the same language, often we have no idea what we're talking about. Let me give you a good example of what happened to me. Years ago, I was delivering a trailer of stuff to a distribution center in Pittsburgh, and there's a shopping mall across the street. And so while they're unloading my trailer, I walk across to the mall to get my hair cut. That was a long time ago. And there's a young lady, as I sat in the chair, she felt compelled to tell me a story about something really, really odd that had happened to her, and So she's sharing this story of how surprised she was at it, and I guess maybe I was sort of surprised at it too, and so my response was, golly, Ned, that's goofy as all get out. And I'm expecting her to go, yeah, I know, right? But instead, there's this silence. And I look up in the mirror and I see her, and she's standing back from the chair looking puzzled, and I realize that what I had said to her makes perfect sense in Roanoke, Virginia. But it does not probably in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And so I compounded the problem because I started laughing and I just couldn't stop. And she steps back and she has her scissors pointing out. She's this big guy this guy's gone crazy. I finally was able to compose myself and explain to her what I meant by that phrase. Now the phrase, golly, Ned, I never could convey to her who Ned was because I really have no idea. I thought about this story. As a matter of fact, many of you here tonight might be going, what? What? What's he saying there? But as I thought about this story, I considered our gospel passage for this morning, and I thought of it in light of the entire teaching that we've looked at from Matthew chapter 5. Because we often speak to those outside of the faith with words and phrases that make no sense to them. But the problem is made more difficult when our lives and our testimonies do not match up with our words. So today we are in week 5 of a 5-part series of Matthew chapter 5. Say that real quick 5 times. This series began with a look at the teaching of Jesus in the Beatitudes. And in the 8 sections of the Beatitudes, he begins by the process of what it means to know Christ. And then as we go on through the Beatitudes, how it looks, what happens in the process of coming to know Christ and learning to live for him. We begin by coming to him as poor in spirit, as beggars, completely in need of his mercy and grace. And that's where we find comfort and peace in him, because we find that as we come to him in that way of humility, that we find that he's waiting for us. He's waiting to bring us into the family of God and to give us the kingdom of God. This entire process works in us to produce dramatic changes within us as to how we live and think. The Holy Spirit now works in those that have come to Christ and found that He was waiting, the Holy Spirit begins to work in those, and a dramatic change happens, a change that everyone is able to see and recognize, those who have known us. This relationship with God in Christ also causes us to hunger and to thirst for righteousness, because we long to please God. He's now the object of our affections. And then Jesus taught us that when we turn by faith to Him, we become those who are pure in heart. We become those who have a single-minded devotion to Him and a commitment to Him. In the past 2 weeks, we've discussed how even what we think about has consequences, because what we think about changes the focus of our hearts and it influences our actions. We saw how having murderous thoughts towards someone, the way God views that is actually we are guilty of murder. And that even looking at someone other than your spouse with lust is to commit adultery in God's eyes. Last week we discussed this issue of not dealing with lust and how it turns into sexual perversion and things like pornography and adultery. And this led us to the subject of divorce last week and how it's against the design of God for one man and one woman to be faithful forever, and how it destroys families and the fabric of society. All these things happen to professing Christians because they fail to live in accordance with the promise and the commitment that they made when they first came to Christ. When our focus is no longer on God and His glory, then we find that the object of our affection changes, and it'll always be on something else instead. When we forget that God is holy and we must be holy as well, there really is no limit to how far we can fall. And so this morning, our gospel reading from Matthew 5 takes us into the final two areas of concern in this chapter. Both the command not to seek revenge, but to become a servant, and the command to love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, are virtually impossible to obey without the power and the love of God that's only found through the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. Now, before we look at these passages individually, I want to consider the themes that are found in our Old Testament, our Psalm, and our Epistle reading this morning. There's an important central teaching in these passages that will enable us to better understand how it is we are to see our gospel passage. In Exodus 24, 12 through 18, God calls Moses to come up to Mount Sinai so He can give him the law and the commands that are for Israel's instruction as to how they are to live up in the face of God, how they are to live amongst their fellow men. So let's read Exodus 24, 15 through 18. Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. And the glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day He called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. And Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Now can you imagine what it must have been like for Moses to walk right into the presence and the glory of the Lord and to dwell there, surrounded by His glory? The glory that from the valley appeared to be a devouring fire. And Moses walks right into the middle of that. And we see the effect of that upon him. And 10 chapters later, as he comes down off the mountain, Exodus 34, 29 through 30, it says, Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand. As he came down from the mountain, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. There's a lot to unpack in these passages, but the point, that I want us to see this morning is that living in the presence of God produces within us a noticeable change, an effect that is evident to everyone around us. To Israel, it instilled in them a fear of even coming close to Moses, and it should have, because to stand in the presence of God is a holy and an awesome thing. For those who do not have a relationship with God, it should produce in them a holy fear of the righteous judgment of God. Either way, there will never be a neutral response to the presence of God. And we need to know that. As we choose to live in the presence of God, we will never be seen as neutral to those around us. The psalmist reminds us of this in our psalm for this morning in Psalm 99, 1-5. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is He. The writer of Hebrews warns us of how we are to approach God. We need to know who He is and respond accordingly. In Hebrews 12, 29, it says, therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingship that cannot be shaken, and let us thus offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and with awe, for our God is a consuming fire. So let's now look at our epistle reading from 2 Peter chapter 1, 16 through 19. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For when He received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to Him by the majestic glory, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with Him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart. I mean, the Apostle Peter is writing to encourage the church to follow the gospel message that had been handed down to them by the apostles, and to ensure them that this message that was given by the apostles was the same message with each one, and that anyone who came preaching a different gospel was teaching a false doctrine. He then points them to a time when Jesus was still upon the earth, and He and James and John had gone up on the mountain with Jesus. Let me read to you Matthew 17, 1-3 and 5. After 6 days, Jesus took with Him Peter and James and John, His brother, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And He was transfigured before them, and His face shone like the sun, and His clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with Him. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. And it said the three disciples were terrified at this sight, but when God spoke, when the Father spoke, they fell upon their faces to the ground. It was the Holy Spirit that was moving in their midst even then. Peter later writes about this incident in the passage we discussed in 1 Peter. Because what he saw there is, he writes about this as a revelation that continued to encourage him to be faithful. Because what he saw there, he saw Moses, who was the giver of the law, and Elijah, who was considered the prophet that was a forerunner of Jesus. He was a prophet that didn't just speak the word of God, but he could call down the power of God. He was the forerunner of Jesus as far as the prophetic. And so what Peter and James and John are seeing is that the law and the prophets have come down to encourage and to glorify and to honor the one that they had pointed to all along and to give Him glory. And then the Father speaks and says, this is my Son Listen to him. I am well pleased with him. You should listen to him. And God knew that the time was going to come that the religious leaders would condemn them and accuse them of neglecting the law and bringing shame upon God and upon Judaism. And during those times, they could remember that they had witnessed on the Mount of Transfiguration that the law and the prophets came to glorify this Messiah. And they would stay the course because that's who they were following. Peter then points out that what they had seen was a brief glimpse into the divine glory that Jesus would bring back on his return. The prophetic word of Jesus promising to come back was made certain as he beheld him in his glory, is what he says in 1 Peter. And once again, we have the example of the effect of being in the presence of God. Peter writes, it becomes as a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your hearts. Peter, the very one who out of fear of the Jews had denied that he even knew Jesus, now is the one who is filled with the Holy Spirit and is proclaiming that this is the Christ that he will follow. And it's the Holy Spirit that had reminded him of what they had seen in those moments of trouble. And it revealed to him the glory and the lordship of Jesus Christ. And now he boldly writes and he speaks as one who had been transformed by the living presence of God. Like Moses and many others, Peter is now able to stay obedient to the will of God and even give up his life for the one that he loves above all things. This is the context will assist us as we briefly consider our gospel message this morning. Remember that the path that Jesus took the listeners on through the Beatitudes was designed to produce in them the understanding and the strength to follow him obediently. I mean, as we invite him into every area of our life, he is the one that strengthens us. He is the one that teaches us by the Holy Spirit. When we spend time with him in prayer and in worship, and we feed upon his word, we experience what it is to live in the presence of God. To deny ourselves that is to be clueless as to his presence. There's nothing that he asks us to do that is impossible if we choose to follow him and allow him to move in us freely, in us and through us. But the problem comes when we decide to take control and run things ourselves. And then we come to passages like these ones we're dealing with in the gospel reading this morning, and they seem virtually impossible. Let's read again Matthew 5, 38 to 42. You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. Last year, the movie Criminal with Kevin Costner came out, and I don't recommend this. It was an interesting movie, but one of the phrases that you hear people still quote, and it's on the even on the internet, you'll see this all the time. If you hurt me, I'll hurt you worse. I think that sentiment is actually not considered that unusual in our culture. And it certainly wasn't in the ancient Middle East or today in the Middle East. I remember believing that if I wanted someone to leave me alone bad enough, the thing that I should do is hurt them so badly that they never wanted to mess with me again. In the movies, our heroes are those who would inflict damage, severe damage, against the villains, and to the point that the villain is overwhelmed. And we cheer and we admire them and wish we had heroes like that. Now, Jesus is not speaking out against military action that protects a nation and its people, but he's addressing corruption of the passage in Exodus 21:24, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. The intent of the law was that the punishment would be equitable and it would fit the crime. This excluded enacting vengeance or applying varying standards for different social classes. And Jesus is contradicting the misinterpretation of the law that should apply to personal vengeance. Now, it's wrong to think that Jesus means that a physical attack cannot be resisted or defended against. When Jesus speaks of a slap on a right cheek, actually to slap someone on the right cheek is to have to backhand them, which is insulting, it's humiliating. So Jesus does not mean that anyone who hits you on the right side of your head with a baseball bat, that you should turn and offer him your left. What he means is personal relationships, when people insult us, when they come against us, that we are not to fight back. We are not to insult them back. That we should not consider an insult something that means war. He's teaching his listeners to respond to evil by making a deliberate choice to do more than is required by the law. That our choice will be an act of love. That if someone insults us, we would see their heart and we would want them to know Christ as we know Christ. At that time in Judea, they were under Roman military occupation and under military law. Any Roman soldier might command a Jew to carry his knapsack for a mile, no more than a mile according to the law. But Jesus is saying if he does that, carry it with him for two. And why would he do that? Because the love of God is revealed and the example that the kingdom has come is revealed in that. Remember that Jesus wasn't going to send his disciples merely to the Jews. He was sending them to the world, which required they must begin to act and think differently. It must be their intention to always reveal the love and the power of Christ. And this same principle is seen in our final section in verses 43 to 45. You have heard that it was said, "You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust." The Mosaic law commanded in Leviticus 19:18 that you love your neighbor as yourself. Yet teachers in the days of Jesus added the opposite misapplication. You are to love your neighbor, but you are to hate your enemy. You are to hate the uncircumcised, is what the Jews taught. Those who are not of the house of Israel, you must hate them. They are your enemies. And Jesus knows that we're going to have enemies, but our response to them is love. Trusting that God will protect our cause. And that God will bring reconciliation to our enemies if we love them, to the point that they come to know Christ too, and they become our friends. That was to be the goal. Not to defeat them, not to embarrass them, not to shut them down. The disciples' attitude to religious persecution must go beyond non-retaliation and instead become the way to demonstrate God's love and mercy. That is so different than the mindset in America today. But I want to point you back to 2007 and an incident in the Amish country of Pennsylvania. You remember the story. A man walks into an Amish schoolhouse in Nickel Mines, Pennsylvania, and he shoots 10 little girls. 5 of them die, and then he kills himself. We were shocked at such an act of evil, especially against such a peaceful people. But the greater shock for most of America came by the reaction of this tiny Amish community. Donald Grable, he's a sociologist at nearby Elizabethtown College. He wrote a book about this. He co-authored a book called Amish Grace, How Forgiveness Transcended Tragedy. And he wrote this: I think the most powerful demonstration of the depth of Amish forgiveness was when members of the Amish community went to the killer's burial service at the cemetery. Several families, Amish families, who had buried their own daughters just the day before were in attendance, and they hugged the widow, and they hugged other members of the killer's family. It was later announced that the Amish community raised and donated money to the killer's widow and their three children, because their heart grieved for her loss and her embarrassment. And they gathered around her to let her know that they were grieving together with her. And they offered her love and compassion. Joseph Beeler, one of the counselors that helped the community get through this crisis, was himself changed by their response. And he writes this: tragedy changes you. You can't stay the same. And where that lands you, you don't always know. But what I found out in my own experience with him is if you bring what little pieces you have left to God, he somehow helps you make good out of it. And I see that happening in this school shooting as well. One just simple thing that the whole world got to see was this simple message of forgiveness. And he writes that as he watched them heal, he realized that their forgiveness is what speeded up their healing process, because they weren't holding on to this bitterness and this hatred of one that ordinarily you would have considered your enemy. They chose the way of Christ instead. This is living like Jesus. But it can only happen when we allow the Holy Spirit to live and move in us and in every area of our lives. I mean, if we could live the way that Jesus told us to in Matthew chapter 5, we would be truly perfect. We would never hate or slander or speak evil of another person, or we've never lust in our own heart or covet anything. We'd never make a false oath. We would always be completely truthful. We would not always insist upon our own rights, but we see the greater way to love. We would always love our neighbors and even our enemies. If we could just keep these things that Jesus commands us here, we would truly have a righteousness that exceeds the scribes and the Pharisees that he commanded in chapter 5, verses 20. The very thing that we must have, he said, to enter the kingdom of heaven. There's only one man who has lived that way, and that's, of course, Jesus Christ. So what about the rest of us? Are we left out of the kingdom of God? Of course, the answer is emphatically no. The answer to that question brings us back first circle to our first week, where we begin that process. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Don't you love the way that Jesus has led us through this chapter? He begins by calling us to surrender to his love and his mercy. Come to him as beggars. And he promises that the reward is intimacy with him and all that the kingdom of God affords. Then he ends with the demand that we be perfect even as his Father is perfect, which is something that we simply cannot do apart from coming to him as beggars and asking for forgiveness. If we're to go forth in the name of Jesus, if we're to live in the power of his Holy Spirit, it must begin on a bended knee, with a broken and a contrite heart. All these things that we have seen in this chapter are undoable apart from the Holy Spirit's presence within our lives. I suggest we begin now, inviting the Lord into every area of our lives, that nothing would block what the Lord wants to do in us. Let's just spend a little time in prayer, asking God to move in us in power. Again, I'm going to come to the altar, and I invite you to come if you'd like to pray as well.